Folks, welcome to this week's Bible study and current events. We're glad you're with us, and I'm really thrilled that more and more people are saying they're watching us on livestream.com, and I mean that. We're working hard right now. I don't know how I'm going to do this, but I ain't in charge of this. Getting on Facebook, seeing watching on Facebook all the country. Don't know how that's going to work. I know Phil and Barry got a job ahead of them, but that's why they're here. But anyway, it's just good to have you today. I do mean that. Welcome to it all, and we're going to do about always a current event issue. Then a Bible study. I'm going to start reading a few scriptures of mine in the book of Isaiah. And before we get into the current events, this may go a little longer than an hour today, because I got several things I want to share, and I don't want to rush through it, if you all don't mind. Because it's important that we take what's happening, chapter 66 of Isaiah, to take what's happening and bring it into light of the scripture. Nothing is happening that is not ordained eventually to happen because our Father made it this way. Although we have been warned, admonished, blessed, persecuted, punished for our sins over the centuries, people never seem to learn there is a holy God in heaven, and that eventually you reap what you sow. Mm-hmm. Is that true?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And we should not be discouraged. I said this many times, I said again. Do not be discouraged because you see judgment coming. Be encouraged to the fact that our God's word is true. That should give us all a blessing. Now, Isaiah chapter 66. If I can read a few verses, you don't mind.
Hold on. 7:1.
Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build unto me? And where is the place of my rest? For all those things hath mine hand made, for those things have been, saith the Lord. But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of contrite spirit, and trembleth at my word. He said, I'll come to the humble that seek my face. Mm-hmm. Not to the haughty, not to the proud, not to the wise men of this world. Now this is pertaining to sacrifices, of course, the Old Testament, and relaying the message, they were offering unclean sacrifices. Now, we wouldn't do it today, would we?
No.
Would we? He that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man. He that sacrificed a lamb is as if he cut off a dog's neck. He that offered the oblation is as if he offered swine. In other words, they were bringing forth impure sacrifices to him. And our sacrifice today is a sacrifice of praise and obedience. If you don't give him pure praise and obedience, you're offering swine blood to him. Now think about that.
You're offering or Cain. Okay.
Yeah. He that burneth incense is he blessed an idol. Yea, they have chosen their own ways, and their soul delighteth in their abominations. And I don't want to start a sermon on this, but as a nation in America today, even in the churches, do they not delight in their abominations?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
They really think they're praising God with their abominations, and they're so naive and so ignorant and willfully ignorant, they will not admit they're wrong. I also will choose their delusion, and will bring their fears upon them. Have you ever seen that? Can you remember any time in history when this nation walked in so much fear?
No.
This nation feeling fear of nobody or nothing.
Oh, that's yeah. Exactly right. Prime motivator.
It is. Mm-hmm. Because when I called, none did answer. When I spake, they did not hear, but they did evil before mine eyes, and chose that in which I delighted not. Hear the word of the Lord, ye that tremble at his word, your brethren that hated you, that cast you out for my name's sake, saith the Lord, be glorified, but he shall appear to your joy, and they shall be ashamed. That's a blessed hope. Mm-hmm. All the tribulation, and we have seen nothing. In America, we are the softest people in the world. Mentally, spiritually, physically, we're a soft people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have seen no persecution speak up.
He's waiting on the rapture.
But he said, that's right. He said, mm-hmm. When it does come, he said, the ones that do that will be ashamed. Now, one more verse, two more verses in chapter 59. This is a hope we have as a people, as individuals. Now look at this. I talk to people all the time who are literally scared. I mean, really frightened. And someone told me, I've sinned to the point I can't be saved than Noah had. Well, that's spitting in God's face.
Right.
That's not true. But Satan has convinced of that.
That's right.
Well, we've crossed the line. We can't. as long as you have a conviction on your heart, you have not crossed the line. It's when the Lord Christ deals with you that you cross the line. You become reprobate. But as long as the Spirit is dealing with your heart and telling you that you need a Savior, a union conviction, there's still hope for you. But don't put it off. Verse 1, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that he cannot hear. But your iniquities, your lawlessness, your sins have separated you between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. Mm-hmm. Now listen to me, people in America and around the world. Not only can't he hear us, he won't hear us until we repent of our sins. And read the rest of that yourself, the hands defiled with blood, your fingers work with lawlessness. All, read it for yourself. But I'm telling you, there's hope. There's hope in repentance. Without repentance, there is no salvation. Without salvation, there is no peace. Without peace, we do drugs. We get drunk. We run around and do all manner of illicit things because we're trying to satisfy the flesh and appease your mind. And we can't do it without Christ. Our nation has been trying for 150 years to get along without a righteous God in control. And we've thoroughly lost it.
I was talking with the West Virginia Agriculture Commissioner, and we were talking about the drug problem. I said, Walt, do you realize these young people have no hope?
Yeah.
And he stopped and he said, you're right, they don't have hope. Of course they don't. Look at the world, the mess it's in. If they don't know that there is a righteous judge, that there is a payday coming, and that there is, you know, the ultimate penal system and the ultimate reward system.
Amen.
How could you, you know, amen. Everyone else is like, come back quickly, Lord. You know?
Well, I want to share with you that this is a good little book. I found this in my dad's library. Josephus, a Jewish historian.
He's one of the greatest.
He won the greatest. He, by the way, he was a Pharisee. I did not know that. But he was not a Christian.
Well,
but he acknowledged Christ. He knew he was here. But he wrote the story because he was part of it. The fall of Jerusalem in AD 70 when Titus took it over. He was there. He witnessed what happened there. It was more horrendous than we can imagine. And I want to share with you this because I think it applies to us today. Jerusalem, because they were God's chosen people, the Jews, they're not all Jews. They were Israelites. They weren't Jews. Jews are a tribe of Judah. They were a mixture. But they thought because they were one time God's people, nothing bad could happen to them.
Hmm.
Does that sound like America?
Exceptionalism,
today?
They call it.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, I'm going to read to you a brief history. This may take more than an hour today, and I don't care. If you got to leave, have fun. It says, Titus now ordered that, and by the way, Titus did his best not to destroy the temple, not to touch the Holy of Holies. He did not want to do that. but the people inside did not want to. They forced him to do this. So the prophecy Christ given about the every stone being torn down, and it happened, but Titus did not want to destroy the temple. Titus now ordered that the people of the city be spared. His soldiers should kill only those fighting them with arms and should take the rest captive. The aged and the infirm were still killed, but anyone who seemed useful was locked within the walls of the court of women, and his fate decided by Fronto, one of Titus' freemen. Fronto killed all who were identified and rebellious as rebellious or robbers. The tallest and most beautiful of the young men were saved for the triumphal procession. Everyone else under the age of 17 was sent in bonds to work the Egyptian mines. A great number were also sent into the provinces to provide amusement in the theaters. I mean, fed to the lions or whatever. Those under 17 were sold as slaves. In the days it took Fronto to make the decisions, 11,000 of the Jews died from starvation just in the process of making decisions. A lot more died before that. The number taken captive during the whole war, 7 years, now that's a completion, was 97,000. The number of perishing during the siege was 1.1 million. Most of them Jewish, but not from Jerusalem. Most of the victims that had come to Jerusalem for Passover being trapped there and died from plague and famine. Before the war, Zetius had asked the high priest to count the number of celebrating the Passover feast. They counted 256,500 sacrifices, which amounted to 2,700,200 purified worshipers. That means they all died in there. Also in the city of the Talmud, 5 million men who were impure, women and foreigners who would not partake the feast. Anyway, what boils down to is, and I can't read it all to you, Millions died inside that city. Starved to death, killed in war. Because God said, and Christ warned them, because you're rebellion, you'll be destroyed. And every stone in the temple will be torn down. And they did it because inside the temple was great riches. He said, I've warned you that this is going to happen. And he predicted the time and it happened. So understand that God, Christ himself warned Jerusalem. He's also warned America that one day judgment's coming. Let's just say a rough figure, 3 million people died in Jerusalem, in that city of Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Now let that think a minute. There's only about 1.5 million in the whole state of West Virginia. They got to the point, and this is all in the book documented. They killed the children, boiled them up and eat them. Mm-hmm. It was so bad that the robbers, the thieves were coming in, the ones that caused all the turmoil, were so repulsed by that, that they didn't even bother to take, they were starving, but they wouldn't even partake of it. Now folks, God's not mocked. This is a good book. I just received it and started reading it. Biblical archaeology. Now I love to study. I love to study history in line with scripture, current events, in line with true scripture, and understand what the Bible tells me and have the confirmation, not the proof. The Bible doesn't need proof. This just confirms what you read here is really happening. But I'll read to you something they found in Egypt. I'm going to find it very quick here. I should have marked the page. In archaeology over the years, they found many pieces of paper. Here we go. And evidence of the scriptures talked about. Now, we all know about the plagues of Egypt, right? Remember the seven plagues of Egypt?
Seven plagues,
yes. And they found a P-A-P-I-R-E-S, Papyrus document.
Papyrus.
Papyrus, yeah. Ipuwer is the name of the document. And in that document that they found, trying to find the time here, back in the, I think the 1600s, 1700s, something like that, exact, can't find. Anyway, it listed in this document the plague of blood, the plague on livestock, the plague of hail and fire, the plague of locusts, the plague of darkness, the plague of Egyptians firstborn, and that the slaves left Egypt after looting this nation. That's all in the Bible, step by step. And the Egyptian historical document just confirmed what we already know.
It's just like the Dead Sea Scrolls. A good guy who was in charge of this,
mm-hmm.
He got fired.
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
Mm-hmm.
But I just love to study these things. See the proof of what you and I know, but faith is true, being brought out. Isn't that beautiful?
Mm-hmm.
And that just makes me more zealous to preach the Bible.
Oh yeah.
More excited to be a believer. And know that my God is real, and he's what he says. Happen. Mm-hmm. You see, the Bible proves this. This doesn't prove the Bible. The Bible just proves this.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Any comments?
Well, the world, you know, they're so immersed in sports and who's going to win. Well, if you want to just talk about who's going to win, we're on the winning team.
Oh, yeah. I heard a song being played on the radio station today, and I can't remember the whole song, but it says, we may lose a battle from time to time, but we win the war. That's a good way to put it. Yeah, we lose a few battles once in a while, at least in our mind.
Mm-hmm.
But I read the last chapter. We win the war. I'm going to share with you a few things written from some of our forefathers or ones before us that I think we need to understand how much we've lost. Whenever we let the founding fathers put the power of the nation in the hands of the people, it was doomed to fall.
Yes.
Without the restraining laws of God being enforced, man cannot govern himself. Is that a fair statement?
Fair.
This is from Thomas Cooley. You ever heard of Thomas Cooley?
Mm-hmm.
The Christian religion was always recognized in the administration of the common law of the land. The fundamental principles of the religion, of that religion must continue to be recognized in the same cases and to the same extent as formerly. Wow, what happened? The American Bar Association acknowledged the historic attitude toward the Christian religion. James H. Landon, Director of Community Programs for the American Bar Association Division of Public Education, Chicago, wrote in Trying Beliefs, the law of cultural orthodoxy and dissent that the Christian law was the common law of the land.
Yeah.
Wow. For most of our country, the majority of Americans have practiced some form of Christian Protestantism. In 1925, public schools still played a significant role in inculcating Anglo-Protestant moral values. Mm-hmm. What happened in the last 100 years?
Slipped away.
In 1890, Harvard Law School Dean Christopher Columbus Langdale pioneered applying Darwin's theory of evolution to the legal process with his innovative case precedent method of practicing law. No other law school at the time taught this. It was against the law to even teach this up until this time in the schools. Mm-hmm. Now today they teach totally opposite of what?
Right. They say that case applies to everything, even though law, a judge's decision can't change law. It only applies to that case, but like you say, now precedent.
Yeah.
That's new. That is not how it used to be. And it used to be the judge instructed the jury that they had the power of jury nullification, which meant they could rule on any law they wanted, whether it was right or wrong.
Yeah.
In that case.
Yes.
And now, if you do that, the judge will probably slap you with jury tampering.
Oh, and no doubt. And probably, put you in prison. Sure. But see, it took some years for them to come around to the view that the law was flexible, responsive to changing social and economic climates. What's that really mean? There
it
is no law.
Anything goes.
There is no law.
I mean, what was good for yesterday is not good for today.
There is no law. If it depends on man's perception of what's right and wrong, there is no law. Holmes had broken, Phil testified that in a little bit. Holmes had broken new intellectual trials, demonstrating that the corpus of law was neither an edict from God nor derived from nature, but was a constantly evolving thing, a response to a continually developing social and economic environment. Now, do you see where he's testing? Folks, this started back in the early 1900s, basically. That the law started evolving and maturing with society.
Okay, we told it.
I just looked at this like, how can it be that we were so stupid? And we bought that for years.
We got a call.
Oh, we got a call?
Yep. Yellow button.
Yellow button. Hello?
Hey, my friend, it's China.
Hey, China, how are you?
I'm doing well. I finally dropped this conference phone, got working again.
Well, good, good.
I've been missing Bible study. I've been feeling sad. I don't like missing it.
Well, I'm glad you're with us today.
Yes, but I was going to comment on something. I've been trying to tell my friends the longest. I said, if we don't keep Adonai's rules and laws, we shouldn't be having man governors. I mean, didn't Adonai said I'm the government? When did that change?
Well, it started back in the late 1800s, especially in the early 1900s. We started leaning to man's understanding.
A lawgiver in our government.
Yep.
Why do we keep turning back to man? I love that teaching when you said America God's church not dead. I need a 4 and 5 of that one because I really enjoy that one.
Okay. Well, you just let us know. Drop us a note.
Okay. Okay. I'm gonna keep listening. Thank
All right.
you so much.
You're welcome, hon. Thanks for calling.
Okay.
Bye bye. Okay. Justice Joseph Story said this on the Second Amendment. The importance of this article will scarcely be doubted. The militia is the natural defense of a free country against domestic usurpations of power by rulers. He didn't say foreign. Mm-hmm. Domestic.
Mm-hmm.
It's against sound policy for a free people to keep standing armies in time of peace. Wow, really? From the easy means which they afford to ambitious and unprincipled rulers to subvert the government or trample upon the rights of the people. The right of the citizens to keep and bear arms has justly been considered as the safeguard of all the liberties of a republic, since it offers a strong moral check against the usurpation of and the arbitrary power of rulers, and will enable the people to resist and triumph over them. Michigan Supreme Court Chief Justice Thomas Cooley quoted Justice Joseph Story in the general principle of the constitutional law. The Second Amendment was meant to be a strong moral check against the usurpation of an arbitrary power of rulers. He said, on the right in general, it may be proposed from the phraseology of the provision that the right to keep and bear arms is only guaranteed to the militia, but this would be an interpretation not warranted by the intent. The militia, as had been explained elsewhere, consists of those persons who, under the law, are liable to perform military duty and are offered and enrolled for service when called upon. If they're right, then we're living to the enrolled to those enrolled with the purpose of the guarantee might be defeated altogether by the action of the neglect act of the government it was meant to hold in check. In other words, they're saying if it's only for those who say active militia, then it's no good for the public. Then the meaning of the provision undoubtedly is that the people from whom the militia must be taken shall have the right to keep and bear arms, and they need no permission or regulation of law for that purpose. Yeah. Justice William Brennan said this: the term "the people" is better understood as a rhetorical counterpoint to the government, that the rights that were reserved to the people were to protect all those subject to the liberties. And it goes on to say that the states were to be the safeguard against a tyranny from the federal government. But I got to ask you a question: when's the last time a state said no?
Because they're prostitutes.
North Carolina.
North Carolina is trying to say no.
Yeah.
But when you think about it, in the long run of things, that these people said that that the federal government could not take over because the states won't allow it. Obviously, they were naive at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But this is what it's supposed to be in. And look where we are today. We have a president that said schools must let children use either bathroom. And almost every state said, oh, yes, sir. Whatever you say, sir. Mm-hmm. True.
Mm-hmm.
And we're seeing, I'm thankful West Virginia is one of the, I think, 12 states who sued the federal government over that. But I will say this and I move on. Sue?
You just say no.
Yeah.
Say no.
You don't go to the court and ask permission to uphold this. You say no. If the war must start, let it start at the border of this state.
Yeah.
Fair enough?
That's right.
You don't sue.
It's just like somebody come to my front door and say, you're going to do this.
No.
No.
You don't even call 911.
No. I don't have to. But anyway, I'm on the Week magazine. Good week for hunting for E.T. after astronomers trained their instruments on a star 94 light years from Earth that is emitting a strong signal. The signal is not a natural phenomenon, said astronomer Douglas Wallach. It was clearly made by a civilization with capabilities beyond those of humankind. You know, you got to wonder what's going on.
You got to wonder big time, yeah.
Good week for getaways after the lawyer for a fugitive Lyle Jeffs suggested in court filings that the Utah polygamist leader is unavailable to stand trial in a food stamp case fraud because he may have experienced the miracle of rapture.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Whoa.
That's a new one.
It disappeared.
Good week for image repair after former Republican presidential candidate Rick Perry announced that he will be a contestant on the upcoming season of Dancing with the Stars. The former Texas governor will compete against a cast of other has-beens, including disgraced Olympic swimmer Ryan Lockheed and rapper Vanilla Ice. I don't know who that is. But anyway. So that's the world's going to watch Dancing with the Stars.
Yay.
Wow. Bad week for pretension after high-end retailer Barney's was widely ridiculed for selling a pair of distressed sneakers outfitted with the duct tape for $585. Critics called the sneakers poverty appropriation. I don't know.
Buy a $3 pair at dollar store, wear them 6 months, we have the same thing.
They buy jeans today full of holes and call it styling.
I call it poverty.
Actually, I have some of work in it. It's pretty well styled.
But you got a hole and you need your britches. It's activating when you kneel down.
It is.
Yes.
An Indian man with a strange taste for cutting tools, is recuperating from a delicate 5-hour operation to remove 40 folded knives from his stomach. After the patient complained of stomach pain. Imagine that. A CT scan revealed the stash of cutlery, some of it open and rusted. I don't know why I used to swallow knives, said the 42-year-old who will receive a psychiatric care. I just enjoyed the taste and I was addicted.
Wow.
Well, Natalie swallowed a wood screw, but that was totally by accident.
And it disappeared.
And it disappeared by a miracle, yeah. So,
another of the Week magazine. Only in America. An Indiana school district has proposed naming a valedictorian. Oh, this is ridiculous. I got to read it. Has eliminated naming a valedictorian because it promotes unhealthy competition among students.
Unhealthy.
But
that's what it is. Gubby, you're right.
Yeah, with the new age.
A Greater Clark School District Superintendent Andrew Millen says students seeking the honor often choose classes that will boost their GPA.
And they're harder usually.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
To avoid that, he wants to honor the top 10% of all graduates. Good week for intolerance after Ohio's Kent State University opened the country's first entirely gluten-free campus cafeteria because officials didn't want students with celiac disease to feel singled out. Really? Man, oh man, we're in a mess.
I know. It's like Cookie called me the other day in Wood County. A sheriff's deputy was pulled over by another sheriff's deputy for going over 100 miles an hour, and he was drunk. They did it. Guess what? They dropped all the charges.
Now, of course.
For, you know, and her son is in prison for just telling the truth and taking the state to court.
Bad week for civilization as we know it after experts in robotics warned that. Now, folks, I remember years ago I talked about this. I talked about this, and this is perverted, but I told you all this years ago. Remember, you remember this, Bill. Mm-hmm. Warned that by the year 2050, humans will be having sex with the cyborgs and may prefer them to other humans. Sex bots would always be available and could never say no, said researcher Joel Snell of Kirkwood College. Robotic sex may become addictive.
Safe sex bot.
Did we talk about this a long time
ago?
Yes,
we did.
Can they have babies?
Think of any perversion, and it's possible and that man can conceive. He will do.
He'll do it. Every time he gets a new device that could be good for man, he perverts it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care whether it's TV, radio, computers, all of it. The atomic, a splitting atom, could be used for great wonders. By the way, this lady, Dr. Diane Harper, will be on the program, I think, next week. She's one of the lead developers of HPV vaccines. She's warning people that's a deadly scam.
Yeah, she's a good woman.
So she'll be on the program next week. HPV vaccines were a scam, and it's deadly.
It's one of the worst.
Yeah, it is. But she'll be on the program hopefully next week.
They're killing people. I mean, let's...
And sterilizing.
Yeah.
That's the 7th and 12th grade. Like, that's the part of the vaccine that they would be getting, 7th and 12th grade.
War on Terror has cost $5 trillion and increased terrorism by 6,500%.
Well, whenever they have a war on something, it increases it.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
I mean, if they did solve the problem, they would be out of a business. But
that's the whole point, war on poverty.
Yeah.
I mentioned that in my article, by the way. Last one got the Lesser of Evils, y'all got a copy of here, about Lincoln freeing the slaves, lie. Roosevelt bringing in
the New Deal.
New Deal.
Great Society.
And I mentioned and Johnson, the War on Poverty.
Great Society.
It's all mentioned. Yeah. So you can still, but anyway. But they were the Lesser of Evils at the time.
Yeah, there you go.
You may be coming a long way, speak up, okay? And from 1950 to 2010, not one mass public shooting was taking place where citizens could carry guns. What did I just say?
Mm-hmm.
In other words, gun-free zones or gun-restricted zones were the targets of choice. Now, why would that be?
Because they don't
have guns. Rob a gun show.
Yeah, exactly.
It's that simple.
But do they mention this on the news?
No.
Remember years ago we talked about a movie called Minority Report?
Oh, yes.
Where they could read your mind before you commit a crime?
Mm-hmm.
Pre-crime.
So, cops using artificial intelligence to stop crimes before they happen, researchers warn.
That's what it is, though. It's artificial.
It is. Cops already using computers to stop crime before they could happen, academics have warned. That's what happened to Thomas. They read his mind, he's going to commit a crime.
That's right.
In a major piece of research called Artificial Intelligence and Life in 2030, researchers from Stanford University has said predictive policing techniques will become commonplace in the next 15 years. Samantha Morton starred in Minority Report playing a woman who had precognitive abilities and could predict crime before they happened. Folks, we are going down the tubes at a fast pace. Soon, that don't affect the ability. I don't know. Maybe they'll read your mind. I do know they can put memories in your mind now. They can artificially put memories in your mind.
Yeah,
you don't even know it.
I think for the most part, Bush, it's deja, it's, no, what do they call it? Let's just put it this way. The polygraphs, they knew when the polygraphs were to be beat in
Bush. Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
But they still went with it because guess what? You can use it. They can use it to control. So they can say, I just read your mind. Yeah, it can be as bogus as anything there is, except that they can brainwash the people to believe it works and then use it as a tool.
Well, Well, the MSR-5.
Well, back for the airports and all, federal building.
Yeah.
You got computers and cameras that look at your face and tell that expression.
Oh, they do. Yeah. If you're hot, or your temperature's up, or you're blushing, or turn, you can be a criminal.
Oh, indigestion could get you in trouble.
Yeah. Exactly. CDC. Now, this has actually happened. CDC declares medical police state, announces power to detain the sick and punish those who do not comply. Now, this has already started. Sinister hidden motives are being revealed at the U.S. Centers for Disease Control. The agency recently announced a new invasive plan for the control of communicable diseases by detaining people suspected of being ill and then forcibly medicating them against their will. Now, I think Nehemiah chapter 9 says they own our bodies.
Yep, they will take ownership of your body.
The CDC's new proposal, published in the Federal Register, number 2016, 18103, will give the agency police state powers permitting CDC officials to detain and forcibly inject chemicals into anyone they deem a threat to public health. There's no rationale for such detainees either. According to the proposal, the CDC defines pre-chemical stage to mean the stage beginning upon the individual's earliest opportunity for exposure to an infectious agent.
Oh, my.
Can you see where this may end up?
Well, it goes to doctor's office or physical. They ask you if you want your flu vaccine and all this other stuff, and you say no. I told you. It's going to come to a time it's going to try to force me to take it.
Oh, that is, yeah, they ask me from the doctor.
And I will not.
And we got to realize they're already chemically doing that. Mm-hmm. You drink a glass of water in a hotel or a restaurant, you're taking in fluoride. You breathe in the air, you're taking in aluminum and barium.
Mm-hmm.
And nanobots.
I went to the dentist and got my daily, mercury. You got your GMO.
Sure.
You got your MSG. So they're poisoning us, right? They're poisoning everybody in this room.
A little bit of time.
There's nobody in this room that isn't being poisoned.
Not only that, even the Wi-Fi and all that's constantly bombarded.
Well,
electric
the
current.
Yeah.
Radiation.
Taking a meter
That's my fault. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You should have had it outside, I guess.
Well, but really, sincerely, I mean, we're being bombarded all the time with electronic devices all the time. Will Clip be replaced? DNC meets to discuss candidates seemingly failing health. They're actually planning on replacing Hillary Clinton. I'm not making this up, okay?
With Michelle Obama.
How do we know they're not even hitting her with a microwave to do this?
Well, you never know. In a stunning turn of events, the Democratic National Convention Committee is set to hold an emergency meeting to discuss replacing Hillary Clinton as a Democratic presidential nominee after she was caught on camera collapsing during 9/11 Memorial in New York.
Yeah.
Emmy Award-winning journalist David Schuster noted in a social media post that Democratic Party operatives are in the process of planning a crisis summit to discuss alternatives to Clinton. The ongoing media speculation about potentially the serious health issues was confirmed with this latest incident. So, and Lindsay says, and it's on the video, just about y'all get a copy of it sooner or later, that he thinks that there could be very well not be an election, because mm-hmm. if anything comes down, you remember the DHS
Department of Homeland Security
said that if one of the candidates die, they'll postpone the election.
Mm-hmm. They're already taking over the polling places.
Yeah.
So they already federalized the polling places, so they already have control of that. So by doing that, anybody say hello, Adolf Hitler?
Well, Lindsay said on the video that Obama will not leave the office. We'll see.
No, he won't leave the office.
Only time will tell. I'm not going to set dates. I'm not that intelligent. I ain't going to try to do that. But Joe Celente, y'all know who he is?
He's an economist.
He is. He's not a Christian, but he is an economist. He's good at it.
Yeah.
Y'all know Jonathan Cahn.
Yes.
Wrote the book, The Harbinger.
Harbinger.
And I can't remember. John Holter, another economic advisor, has said this. Now, I'm not saying this. He said this. The dollar will collapse on the 27th or the 30th.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see.
This month.
Yep.
We will see. I don't know. I'm going to tell on that. Mm-hmm.
Don't save your dollars, that's for sure. Don't save them.
Oh, no. There's nothing saved.
No.
But I do know this for a fact, that I never heard these people said date before. Never. I've heard Slinte say it's imminent, but he never said a date. Now he said a date. I don't know. We'll see. Okay? Mm-hmm. I told Lindsay about that. So you watched Jonathan Cahn. He said, and it's about a 28-minute video. He said, I did. And said, I was shocked to hear what he had to say. But we'll see what happens. I don't know. But what better way to postpone election than a economy collapse?
Desperate people do desperate things.
Absolutely. That's exactly why we obey the government already. We're scared.
Yeah.
Fear is a great motivator. It's a great controller. You know, for years, I reared three sons, and they all turned to be pretty good boys in the long run. But I had a thing in the corner called a switch. Never had touch very often. It was there. They saw that, and fear kept them alive until they learned to respect me because it's right, okay? Anybody ever been there beside me? Okay. So they knew if they did something wrong, get punished.
You've been in the receiving end a lot.
Oh, yeah. But I tried to find, I said, I don't want to have to use that. I want you to listen to what's right, not because you're scared of me.
That's when you
win.
You win.
So anyway, and I'm saying this to glorify our Father. It's not me at all, but my middle son, Jamie, went through some hard times, and he still waits because he brought a lot of us. Listen, eventually you're going to reap what you sow. I saw this do it. I'm sorry. It's fact. But he works now for the power company, and he get to work with some strong Christians. One of the guys he works with, they discuss the Bible all the time. And he said, he's talking about me and the guy that he talked to. He said, well, I listened to Daddy once. And he said, when I feel radical, I turn the radio and listen to Daddy. So yeah, that's really true. He said, I'd like to meet that man, Jimmy. He said, well, you probably will one day if you want to. And he said, a lot of folks don't know how to take him. Some hate him, some love him. But he'll just tell you what the truth is best he can. You know, but I was kind of shocked when the guy said he feels radical. Turn the radio on. So anyway.
You don't want to look for him anyway.
No, I don't want to look for him. This article here is the U.S. presidential election just keeps getting faker. And that's the whole article about this. It's really good, okay? Put that bull down to it, wrote on the list of evils. But it goes on. It destroys Clinton with all the facts. Clinton, Hillary Clinton is a wicked, wicked, wicked woman.
Witch.
A witch. Uh-huh. But Trump's connections to the shadow rulers, Trump is not
the answer.
No.
He's not the savior.
Although this article has been, as so far as highlighted, and the fraud surrounding Hillary Clinton, the point here is not to support Trump. That Donald himself has admired the connection and association with New World Order agents, such as the head of the Rockefeller CFR, Tommy Haas. Trump is also close to PayPal founder, millionaire, and transhumanist Peter Thiel, CIA asset and Saudi arms dealer Adrian Kalosky, as well as Louis Lesser, partner of CIA asset Mayor Alinsky, who was involved in JFK assassination. To what degree Trump is influenced or controlled by these men is an open question. However, we know enough to say that he has tyrannical tendencies, is an ardent Zionist, and a possible or probable pedophile, hardly the choice you want to be given in a free and open society. I know he's a Zionist because his daughter married a Jew. And so he's controlled a lot by Israel. And Israel, I'm not saying necessarily is an evil nation, but it's not one I'm going to support necessarily.
He's also part of the Knights of Malta.
He is. And here is the article. Another Trump, and this is a Freedom article, I'm making this up. Another Trump pedophile lawsuit. Now, is it true? Now, I'm not going to say a man's guilty because he's been accused. But it's another one, not the first one. So I don't know, but I will tell you this. This article, I'll just give you a copy of the first verse of the article. Somebody read that to me if you don't mind, if you got it handy. Read that first verse, Phil, real loud.
Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord, and depart from evil.
So who to trust in, Trump? Yeah. I listen to talk show hosts that almost idolize that man.
Yeah.
Really? I'm serious.
Con job. It's a con job.
It is.
Oh. Got a phone call.
Hello?
Hi, but this is China.
Yes, China.
Hey, I want to make a comment. When I was little, my grandparents always told us, you eat what's at the house. You don't go to a folks' house. When we got food here, I didn't cook all this food. You better eat what's here.
Okay.
Yeah, remember I was listening to you when you said about this week and your boys?
Yeah.
They respected you well. My grandparents never hit us, but their voice got so loud, and I respected them. I said, I better not say nothing else. I better not say anything else. I keep my mouth shut.
Yeah, you knew when to shut up. Well, I understand that. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I understand
and
that.
I'm almost 30 years old, and she can grandma can still yell at me, and I just keep my mouth shut.
Okay.
I've learned, but I would never be older than my elders.
That's true. Okay, thanks again, China.
I was going to make a comment on the Obama thing.
Uh-huh.
I don't see why we can't go back to God's rules and laws. That's the way he originally wanted it to be. I don't understand why we keep turning back to man. That really spiritually makes me angry.
Well, I should. We don't have enough common sense to repent. That's our problem. Well, thanks, Ben or China. I appreciate it.
All right. I'll keep listening.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
This sounds ridiculous, but it's true. A dog is reelected mayor for a third term.
What?
Proving politicians are useless. I'm not making that up. And as millions of Americans struggle to decide whether to elect a volatile narcissist or a calculated whoremongering criminal as their next leader, one Minnesota town is doing politics right. They just reelected a dog to his third term as mayor. Duke, a 9-year-old Great Pyrenees, was the first elected mayor of Coramont, Minnesota in 2014. The first time he won, it was by accident. The small town of just over 1,000 people held an election in which residents could pay $1 to vote. Duke won the race with 12 write-in votes and was treated to an official inauguration. The town's voters were evidently happy with the 2014 fluke. Duke has been reelected twice more recently at the end of August.
Well, as long as they don't do a cat, I can, you know.
Anyway, you know that, but does that bespeak of the insanity and the uselessness of politics?
Bizarre world, but
exactly.
And the dog gets a paycheck.
Yeah, I'm sure he does.
I struggle to make money, and the dog's getting a paycheck.
Abortion, and this, you know, we're going to hear some news. Abortion, which is a infanticide, is the leading cause of death in the U.S. But you don't hear that, do you? You hear heart attack and cancer. But this is a phenomenal figure. 45 to 50 million abortions are performed annually worldwide. 16.4% of them are non-Hispanic whites. 61% are black. 64% are Hispanic.
My.
Wait, what were the percentages?
16.4% are white.
Okay.
61.1% are black. 64% is Hispanic.
Wait, they killed their babies. Is it add up to 100?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that is up to more than 100%, obviously, but that's what goes down, I guess, per numbers. But it's just it's two out of every three deaths.
It's a misprint.
A misprint thing. Anyway, that's true. Two out of every three deaths among blacks, Hispanics are abortion.
Well, it's the highest, yeah.
But just stop and think about this. Now, listen, I won't say this, and I'm going to make a lot of people mad, and I can't help it. God said in His Word that He will not forgive the shedding of innocent blood. 2 Kings 24:4 says it clearly. Mm-hmm. We are fighting the New World Order. We're fighting all these things, and we're allowing the death of innocent children.
Yeah.
God will not hear our prayers. Back in a lump, and I'm not making it up. I sent you a video film on that. Did you get it by any chance, a guy exposing that?
No.
It's there somewhere.
I'll find it.
Motherless babies possible as scientists create live offspring without need for a female egg.
Mm-hmm. Say it again.
Motherless babies could be on the horizon after scientists discovered a method of creating offspring without the need for a female egg.
Oh.
The landmark experiment by the University of Bath writes, 200 years ago, biology teaching could pave the way for a baby born from DNA of two men.
Oh, no.
No.
It was always thought that only female egg could spark the change in a sperm required to make a baby, because an egg forms from a special kind of cell division in which just half the number of chromosomes are carried over. Imagine that you could take skin cells and make embryos from them. This would have all kinds of utility. Sperm cells form in the same way, so that when a sperm and egg meet, they form a full genetic quota, with half our DNA coming from our mother and half from our father. But now scientists have shown embryos could be created from cells which carry all the chromosomes, which means that, that in theory, any cell in the human body could be fertilized by sperm.
Well, that's a brave new world.
Yeah, it is.
What happened to the X and Y chromosomes?
That's Aldous Huxley's.
But I have a hard time in my mind conceiving that. I can't. That's so against nature.
And the question I would have, if a child comes for that, will they have a spirit?
I don't know. Good question.
Mm-hmm. Excellent question.
Another sports association leaving North Carolina over a bathroom law. I'm not going to read this to you, but North Carolina said no.
Oh, they're leaving. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, the sports association are not going to play ball games anymore because the North Carolina said we don't want men using women's bathrooms.
They haven't caved in yet, have they?
No, they have not.
No, thank goodness.
And I have a phone number here, but you can call the phone number or you get your runaround. But I did give the address last night for the governor of North Carolina. You can write Pat McCrory, and tell him thanks. I really want to thank you for this. But the National Basketball Association and some others have pulled out, so we're not going to play more games there because they won't let the men use the girls' bathrooms.
And everyone that participates, watches those, supports those in any way, they're aiding in the bathroom.
They're part of it.
Yep.
Absolutely. I agree.
And the one standing up the strongest against it is the woman.
Mm-hmm.
Not the men. It's the woman.
Well, the men probably enjoy it.
Well, society has a hard time fighting against the woman where they can fight against the men.
Now, we saw this. I'm going to read this to you. Captain Pingsmith, I know who he is.
Oh, yeah.
California is now forcing elementary school kids to share a co-ed bathroom, reports the Capital Resource Institute. Now, listen. This week, we were notified by concerned parents that a 9-year-old boy walked into the boys' bathroom at Cloverton Unified School District Elementary School, and upon entering, found a girl squatting, hovering over the urinal. This young boy was both disturbed and confused. Why was a girl in the boy's bathroom? Why was she using a urinal? Why was a biological girl exposing herself to a boy in this intimate facility? We ask ourselves the same question. A group of parents of Clovis Unified School District has taken the initiative to attend school board meetings to advocate on behalf of the children. One of the issues they've voiced concern over is the district policy to allow students to use facilities and locker rooms based on their gender identity, rather than their biological sex. I've got a question to ask these parents. I don't want to be nasty. Why the hell are your kids in those schools?
Mm-hmm.
Fair enough?
Mm-hmm.
Why go to a school board meeting, get your children out of there, and teach them at home? This makes me angry. Very angry.
And then look what the parents did in Panama. We showed that.
Oh, yeah. Exactly.
They stood up and said no.
They said no. Lawsuit, girls exposed to transgender twerking and grinding in locker room. We knew this would happen.
Yeah.
And yet people sit back in silence and put their children in these hell holes you want to call schools. They're perverting their minds, destroying their souls, and sending them to hell, and you pay the tax dollars to keep it going that way. If that's China, then we got to move on to somebody else, okay? Anyway. A public high school in town of Virginia, Minnesota, is accused of turning a blind eye as a transgender student engaged in twerking, grinding, and all sorts of scurrilous activity in the girls' locker room, according to an explosive lawsuit filed in federal court. Alliance Defending Freedom is representing at least 11 families, asking the court to stop Virginia public schools' policy that opens up showers and locker rooms to opposite sex. School policies should promote the rights and safety of every student, but that's not what Virginia Public Schools is doing. And it's certainly not what the Department of Education and Justice are doing. ADF Senior Counselor Gary McLeod said, no child should be forced into an intimate setting like a locker room with someone of the opposite sex. Name this defendants in lawsuit are Attorney General Loretta Lynch, Independent School District Number 706, Virginia School District, and Secretary of Education John King Jr. I reached out to the district, but they're not commenting. No student should be forced to use private facilities at school, like locker rooms and restrooms, with students of the opposite sex. The district opened its school locker rooms and showers and restrooms to boys to identify as girls after the Justice Department. And the Department of Education issued a directive warning schools to either accommodate transgender students or lose federal funding.
Oh, so what?
Yeah.
Keep your money.
Prostitution.
Yep.
No government agency should hold hostage important education fundings to advance a lawful agenda, the lawsuit states. No school district should take its trade students' constitutional and now listen, folks, this is where I got all missed. Constitutional statutory rights for dollars and cents, especially when it means abandoning a common sense practice that long protected every student's privacy and access to education. The Constitution had been used to destroy the nation. Constitutional right to kill a baby. Constitutional right to be a homosexual and use the bathrooms. The Constitution had been used to destroy it because without the morals of God in it, it can't work.
So the Constitution goes against the morals now.
It does.
And now, so we you can only call once.
But yeah, please, only call once if we would just during the, during the teaching. Yeah. We would like for you to call, but one time, follow we can handle, okay? Under the school's district policy, the transgender student identified as student X was allowed to use the bathrooms and locker rooms of his choice. The child also allowed was also allowed to participate in on girls' athletic teams. ADF alleged student X engaged in inappropriate and sexually aggressive behavior, leaving some girls in tears. Among the allegations, student X commented on girls' bodies. Now listen, he commented on girls' bodies in the locker rooms, including asking girl playing the F about her bra size, asking her to trade body parts with him. Student X danced to loud music with sexually explicit lyrics while twerking. I don't know what twerking is. Grinding. What? I don't want to say. What is twerking?
It's
grinding is anal sex.
But what's twerking?
I'm not sure.
And lifting up his skirt, or lift up his skirt to reveal his underwear. Student X would dance in a sexually explicit manner, dancing like he was on a stripper pole. Two songs with suggestive lyrics, including Milkshake by Kellis. I don't know what that even is. The schoolgirls who felt uncomfortable, they should consider using it second, were told they should consider using a secondary locker room in the basement of the elementary. In other words, get out of your own locker room, get downstairs. Plaintiff B and nearly half the junior varsity squad changed in the secondary locker room in hope that their privacy would not be violated. Midway through the season, Plaintiff A was told she could use a vacant boys basketball locker room for privacy. But it wasn't long before the transgender student showed up in that locker room. On such occasion, student X walked into the boys basketball locker room while girl Plaintiff A was in her underwear and removed his pants while he was near her and other girls who were also changing. This incident deeply upset girl Plaintiff A. It signaled to her that there was no place in school where she could preserve her privacy under the new policy. ADF attorney Matt Sharp told me the school district turned a blind eye to complaints raised by the girls and their parents. The school was very unsympathetic, Sharp said. This is showing what we have been warning for months now. When you strip away student privacy, there's going to be consequences for that.
That's a suspension. Any kind of inappropriate behavior in the school may be suspension. Doesn't matter what sex.
Automatic, period.
Period, that's it.
But the parents are complaining. Another major hospital in Melbourne has 250 children who are being assisted by the gender dysphoria unit. Yahoo 7 News Australia reports a four-year-old who identifies as transgender has begun to transition before their first day of school, hoping to complete the full transformation by 2017.
There is no full transformation.
I get angry and I don't apologize. Why in the name of God and all that's holy are we so damn stupid? And I mean damned. Not in a curse way, in a biblical way. This really ticks me off, Joe.
But it does.
While the child is the youngest in Australian record to change her gender, the New South Wales government has revealed hundreds of other children are being referred to the state's hospitals for gender dysphoria. The four-year-old is reportedly being supported throughout the transition by the Education Department and is part of the state school's Safe Schools Program. Safe Schools Program. Yes, the Safe Schools Program. Safe for whom? Deputy Secretary of School Operations Gregory Pryor made his announcement at a budget hearing which presumably means the four-year-old child is receiving public funds for a sex change.
Do they have a mother and a father, male and female, or what?
Can't be. Could be. That'd be up to them, wouldn't it?
Who knows?
No mention of how the parents of the four-year-old had come to the decision. No mention of the discussion with the child that led to this decision. You don't discuss this with a four-year-old. He or she should not even know what the other one looks like yet. Am I being right?
You're absolutely right.
The New South Wales government doesn't just stand aside. It supports this madness. The folks, don't throw stones at Australia. We are doing the same thing. The four-year-old, did he, she comes up with this idea out of the blue? He, she expressed it in what terms? You know, how does a four-year-old say, Mommy, I want to be a little girl? How does they know?
The only way that can happen, but if the parents are telling the little boy he's a girl.
He, she is supposed to understand the medical procedures and the consequences. The doctors go along with this. We have a four-year-old boy coming in today to begin sex change. Good, the team will be ready. Not a flicker of doubt. Here is a Wikipedia identification of gender dysphoria. Gender dysphoria is, or gendered identity disorder, GID, is dysphoria distress a person experiences as a result of the sex and gender they were assigned at birth?
Assigned.
No.
Lucky you can change it. A sign? This is supposed to be some sort of arbitrary labeling that is handed to an infant. Well, call this one a male. The next one will be a female. This whole social program has gained so much steam that many people are paralyzed. They refuse to express outrage.
How could you be paralyzed?
How could you not be angry?
Yeah.
They refuse to point out the obvious. They knuckle under. The criminally delusional parents who go along with this program for their own children consider themselves enlightened. They're in a trance and they feel good about the trance. Yes, our 4-year-old is undergoing gender transition this week, and we think it's wonderful. What coaching did these parents engage in with their very young child to push along this insanity? A boy put it on his mother's dress one day, and then a parent sat down with him and engaged in a deep conversation. A 4-year-old is now the ruler of his or her own fate. This is legalized mutilation and torture, undertaken as a proper medical procedure. The doctor should have licensed the strip, and should be sent to prison. They should share the cell with the government officials who support the crime. On some level, medical sex change for children is an outgrowth of an obsession about children being spatial. Ultra spatial. The child's wisdom extends to all sorts of insights he/she has about life. A child does have a free and open attitude toward life, but this has nothing to do with making decisions that have enormous consequences for him/her. And the word consequences hardly begins to describe this mutilation. I'm tempted to take the usual hollow question: what has become of our society? But the answer is clear: there are masters and slaves. The slaves are going along. The masters are psychopaths. But that leaves a lot of middle ground where parents, educators, and bureaucrats are willingly cooperating with destruction. It's not simply a lack of courage. It's self-induced brainwashing.
That's it.
Voting for the lesser of evils. Read the article. This is freedom. Freedom is a good thing. What could be more free and innovative than a child deciding his or her own sex at the age of 4? We're creating a better world. Their eyes are bright, their smiles are wide. And if medical sexual mutilation of a child is gladly permitted, what isn't permitted? What voluntary or mandated medical procedure will be ruled out as too grotesque? That's a question that should be asked. For example, shouldn't we support in glowing terms mass sterilization of women through vaccination campaigns that covertly create future miscarriages? After all, in the third world, where such efforts have already been made, in Kenya, for example, overpopulation is a problem. We know it's a problem because decades ago, Henry Kissinger said so. In Australia, where this 4-year-old child is about to go through sex change, every GD doctor in the country should stand up and refuse. And should say, look, Mr. and Mr. Smith, we see what your decision is, and we can't even begin to describe how we feel. Don't look to us for help in committing this horror on your child. If we hear of any doctor who goes along with this plan, we'll publicize his name and, if necessary, physically remove him from the country. We'll see to it he never practices medicine in Australia another day in his life. As for the parents of this 4-year-old, they're lost. They're lost to themselves and their child. They're in a hell of their own making, and they don't even know it. They're happy about it. Now you see how long they call to preach anywhere? Mm-hmm. I told us, I said on the radio tonight, I can remember, I think, one, maybe two times in 23 and a half years on the radio that any preacher said, boy, you're doing a good job, come preach for me. I didn't get called to preach anywhere except New York. Pastor Manning said, come preach in my church. I might look a little different up here in the Bronx, you reckon?
Yeah. You're going to stand out, Butch.
I know, it'd be hard disguised, wouldn't it?
Just don't buy them all wars and play new checks.
But I'm telling you, folks, and I'm saying this humbly before God. You all know me. These people know me very well. Mm-hmm. Am I such a wicked person that they won't invite me to church to preach?
No.
What part of this have I taught that isn't Bible and how it's happening? Why do you want to hide from the truth? Why is it we even go like this? South Africa bars anti-gay U.S. pastor Steven Anderson. Remember Steve Anderson?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, from Texas.
Yeah, no, Arizona.
Arizona.
The Home Affairs Minister said he was refused a visa at the Constitution, as the Constitution prohibits hate speech. This is in
Michael Savage can't go to England.
Yeah, that's true.
Same thing.
Mr. Anderson runs a Faithful Word Baptist Church, which says that homosexuality is an abomination punishable by the death penalty. He said that religious freedom no longer exists in South Africa. I feel sorry for people who live in South Africa, but thank God we still have a wide open door in Bosnia, Botswana. Mr. Anderson reposted on his Facebook page after the decision to refuse him a visa. South Africa has one of the most liberal constitutions in the world, which protects gay rights. We got one too. We're proud of it. Mm-hmm. It'll save us. All right, we're going to read this and we'll move on to Phil's arc in a minute. Transgender restroom bill. Now, you listen to what I'm reading to you. Transgender restroom bill applied to Massachusetts churches. A Massachusetts government commission has claimed that churches may be subject to the state's transgender restroom bill has drawn expressions of concern from local evangelicals. Oh, they're concerned. The United States Constitution has been understood since the founding of our nation as specifically protecting the rights of churches to function in keeping with their deeply held religious beliefs. Terry Doshett, Executive Director of Baptist Convention of New England, told Baptist Press in written comments. Any attempt by a small vocal activist group to strip churches of that right should be vehemently opposed by all people. If they can take a church's right to practice their faith away, imagine what else they can do. And I'll make a comment here. It's not a right, it's a duty.
Yeah.
An issue is the documents released by the Massachusetts Commission Against Discrimination, MCAD, September 1st, explain now how a ban on gender identity discrimination in public accommodations adopted in July will be enforced when it takes effect on October 1st. The document warns even a church could be seen as a place of public accommodation if it holds a secular event such as a spaghetti dinner and is open to the general public. What church is not open to the general public?
There you go.
All persons, regardless of gender identity, shall have the right to the full and equal accommodation, advantages, facilities, and privileges of any place of public accommodation. That includes restrooms and locker room usage based on perceived gender ID rather than biological sex. Mm-hmm. The document explains the violation of the gender identity. This non-discrimination law is punishable by a year in jail and a $25 fine.
Well, think about this. They used to say that the queers were in the closet, right? Mm-hmm. What they're saying is the church has to go in the closet and be private in order to not be under their perversion.
But there's so many Christians going in the closet. You know, that closet has to get crowded.
Yeah, the queers, they come out the window room.
Well, didn't Ohio just went through the same thing, too, about their bathroom policy on the churches?
So far, they haven't tried to enforce it. It looks like Massachusetts is going to try to enforce it beginning of first of all.
Okay.
Now, I want you to let this sink in a minute. The church in Massachusetts, starting 2 weeks, has to let transgenders use bathroom of choice or face a fine or jail time.
They're going to be looking for churches to do this to. I mean, the transgenders.
Bring it on.
Yeah, but the transgenders are going to come in and just.
Bring it on.
Look for the church.
Bring it on. Please bring it to my church.
Mm-hmm. You'll be run off.
By any means necessary. That scared some people to death, I'm sure.
Well, if you only got one.
I know, they probably moved away from the screen.
If you got one up there, you shouldn't have a problem. You know that?
Do what?
Well, if only one restroom, you shouldn't be no problem.
No. Shouldn't be. Yeah. But I'm just saying this to make a point, folks. There's a time for the church to say no. There's a time to say no more. When are you going to do it? Why do you give a dime to these denominations that will not stand against this?
Divisions.
Why do you do this? It's called denominations. He said it's called
divisions.
No, it's in 2 Peter chapter 2.
Heresies.
If they're heresies, when they deny Christ by allowing this kind of abomination before God, they're not a church. Now, I'm showing up here when I get mad because I pulled a gun. I'm going to tell you what, folks. I don't wear that gun for looks. I'm a peaceful man. I'm one of the biggest wusses in the world. But don't you lay hand on my family, my children, or my church family. I'll say this with all conviction. Phil, I don't apologize. No. I'll kill you.
Even Jerry Spence, who defended, what was his name?
Good gosh.
On the mountain.
Randy Weaver.
Randy Weaver said in the trial, and he won, He said even a rabbit will defend its young.
Yeah.
And bite you.
A bird will attack you if you get in the nest.
A hen will.
Yeah.
But we running cow in the Cornell, we got to obey man. I'm trying to calm down here. Now, don't apologize. You don't like me, turn the radio. Go turn it off. Go watch somebody else. Turn on Benny Hinn.
Holy Ghost enema.
Exactly. Phil Hudock, right here at the table with us, worked his buns off to get on a ballot in the state of West Virginia to run for governor. And he got everything done legally and lawfully. Got 7,000 signatures. Got everything in on time to run for governor. And making some headway. I drove in a parade last weekend. We're going through downtown Somerville, and people were applauding what he was saying. As of last night, the Supreme Court ruled yesterday that he did not get his letter of intent in on time. He did, actually. He got it in July, was supposed to be. But they ruled retroactively that back as far as January, because he didn't have it in, he could not run for office. It's a long, convoluted story, but it happened. Now, I'm going to read a letter to you that's published in the Elkins Intermountain paper that Phil wrote last night, that published this morning, the day after this happened. It's a little lengthy, but I'm going to read it to you. If you're in a hurry, I said go take a break. But I'm telling you, folks, if you really believe we live in a free country, that you got a voice that can be heard, even this seat for a long time. The big club shuts others out of which they debate again. When I look back at what happened to me in 2014, bid for U.S. Senate, I asked myself, how can the little guy win when some of the most powerful members of the media have an agenda of crony establishmentarianism, what's a good word, manipulation, and a gall to formulate their so diabolical plans in broad daylight? I should have made more noise. I won't be quiet anymore. What happened to me cannot be swept under the rug and should not be experienced by future candidates. You might say, Hudock, things are never 100% fair, but aren't you stretching things a bit? I have to say that until I experienced the big club, both in 2014 and now with Hoppy Kirchhoff's slander, I couldn't really wrap my mind around it. People tend to set the limits of what others are capable of by their own imaginations. Imagine that. And what is most disconcerting is these connivers don't fear reprisal or public indignation because of their level of hubris. It is as though they love to have it so. The people, folks, he made comment, that's Bible. The people don't care. They love to have it that way. This brings to the question exactly how much blame it is on we, the people, who can entrust these individuals as watchers. Who is watching the watchers? Why is there no fear of anger and outrage? Look in the mirror. Ultimately, the buck must stop here. To keep the infestation and stink of those not so cute ladybugs out of my house, I recommend the insecticide Bug Stop. I don't have stock in the company, and it really works well. Folks, it's past time for Buck Stop. I formally declare that it Buck Stop season commencing immediately. I was shut out of the debates in 2014, and the big club has shut me, David Moran, and Charlotte Pitt out of the debates in October. In this case, the big club is the West Virginia Press and Broadcast Association, members of the very media that we entrust as the Fourth Estate. We hear about honest and fair elections. Really? Where? Not here. It's not a pretty picture, but again, use Buck Stop here. Don't worry about being Mr. Nice Guy. Think about your children. Don't they deserve a better world than this? In this case, being a watcher is not synonymous with being an observer. Action is a paramount. You give your support with not just dollars and votes, but by that which you publicly support or boycott. The donkey fund debates should be boycotted by all civic-minded people. Of course, there will be those who expect favors who always will attend, but are meaning those who rise above temporary and self-serving concerns in our own Buck Stop here. At this point, I would be seriously remiss if I didn't share the following. Luke 13:3 and repeat it in Luke 13:5. I tell you nay, but except you repent, ye shall all likewise perish. These words were uttered by Jesus in response to the attempting to shirk their own responsibilities. Very good letter, Phil Hudock. You will say anything before we close?
No, that was before I found out I was removed from the ballot. But desperate people do desperate things, Butch.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know that they won't shut you up, and you know why I don't get invited to preach.
Yeah.
You know, I had a preacher invite me to come to Tennessee Church one day not too long ago. He said, come some Sunday. I said, I carry a pistol. He said, I don't care. He's a cop. He said, I don't care to carry a pistol. Mm-hmm. He's one of the few that's ever invited me to come to church, much less come preach. But with all this, the proof where I read to you in the scriptures, he can save us. He will save us, but he will not do it through our sins.
Right.
Fair enough?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Back in a little bit.
Text team, Hoppy, I'm esteemed you're mentioning Phil Hudock's bid for governor. The Southern Poverty Law Center included him on their top 10 dangerous candidate list.
Hoppy? You said what?
The Southern Poverty Law Center included him on their top 10 dangerous candidate list. Dangerous.
Dangerous. Does Hudock plan to collect scalps? Look at this dangerous character. No. As you can see here, in the most recent stand against the police state, we only foiled the biometric identification at our tea party at the Summersville DMV. Did Phil create a man-eating puppet? Look at this monster that Hudock made, like Frankenstein. I'll let you decide. Is Obama a globalist puppet? Or does Obama head really belong on Mount Rushmore?
If you've got health care already, then you can keep your plan if you are satisfied with it.
If you like the plan you have, you can keep it.
I've now been in 57 states. I think one left to go.
So if somebody wants to build a coal-powered plant, they can. It's just that it will bankrupt them because they're going to be charged a huge sum for all that greenhouse gas that's being emitted.
We are not just going to be waiting for legislation. I've got a pen and I've got a phone.
Raising the debt ceiling, which has been done over 100 times, does not increase our debt.
And everyone who already has health insurance will keep the benefits and protections this law already has put into place. Period.
Period.
Period. End of story.
We cannot continue to rely only on our military in order to achieve the national security objectives that we've set. We've got to have a civilian national security force that's just as powerful, just as strong, just as well-funded.
As I've already said, I have had my military.
Say, I want to speak plainly, clearly, honestly. If you already have health care, you don't have to do anything.
I've now been in 57 states. I think one left to go.
I have two words for you. Predator drones. You will never see it coming. You think I'm joking?
I wish you were. Hoppy, did you care to find out if the SPLC said I am dangerous? Hoppy, it is a big story. And you've got it all wrong. It's extremist, not dangerous. Except for a few inaccuracies, I'm rather proud of the article. Chairman of the West Virginia chapter of the Theocratic and Anti-LGBT Constitution Party? That's true. With a history of Christian-based activism? True. Petitioned the Department of Motor Vehicles to remove their photos from driver's licenses? That is not true. As you can see here, in the most recent stand against the police state, we only foiled the biometric identification with our Tea Party at the Summersville DMV. In 2012, Hudock's daughter was banned from her high school because the family refused to comply with new vaccination requirements. Who also was allowed to participate in its commencement ceremony. Well, she was valedictorian. They failed to mention that here. A secret plot to form a socialistic global government known as the New World Order? Their words. On his site, Hudak asserts that he serves God, family, and country in that order, and says that the New World Order is an anathema to everything I believe in. So, Hoppy, why did you say I'm dangerous? The late George Carlin warned us what is dangerous.
Because the owners of this country don't want that. I'm talking about the real owners now. The big, the wealthy, that the real owners, the big wealthy business interests that control things and make all the important decisions. And they own all the big media companies, so they control just about all of the news and information you get to hear. They got you by the